Good evening, Memorial. Tonight's presentation by the 100th Year Anniversary Committee is entitled Our Pastor's Pearls. Here is a brief description about pearls. A pearl is a precious gemstone, unique and valuable, formed with a purpose to protect. Pearls come in different shapes, sizes, and colors, but yet each one is special in its own way. They are rare, one of a kind. They shine, signifying femininity and love. The person blessed enough to hold a pearl becomes elevated, royal, and dignified. This is why our pastor's wives are called our pastor's pearls. Memorial Presbyterian Church has been blessed with the leadership of 13 senior pastors over the last 100 years. They have served with us through the lean years of the Great Depression and currently are shepherding us through a worldwide pandemic. The pictures and stories of our senior pastors are recorded in the church museum for all to see. But we don't often hear the stories behind the pastor's wives. History informs us that behind every great man, there is a phenomenal woman. Join us as we take a look at some of these memorable women. God bless and enjoy.
From Florence C. Hawk Moyer, wife of our first pastor, Herbert E. Moyer, who served MPC from 1920 to 1925. To our current First Lady, Donette Williams, we will highlight the women beside the men that served Memorial, with special highlights from the two most recent past First Ladies, Antonia Damon and Yvette Beckett Tuggle.
Pearl Bessie Owen served alongside her husband, Reverend Richard W. Owen, from 1941 through 1958. Together, they organized youth groups, evening prayers, and song services to lift the spirits of the congregation during those trying times of World War II. It was during this period that the Women's League was organized. As a result of their vision and hard work, several aspects of this ministry are still celebrated and supported today. Pearl Shirley Munch served alongside her husband, Reverend Donald L. Munch, from 1958 through 1962. They were blessed with two children. This Aquila and Priscilla team responded to the needs of the community through education and outreach. Their dynamic presence strengthened and flourished the Sunday school and youth groups. These ministries are still a vital part of the continued history of Memorial Presbyterian Church.
We have been blessed to have the opportunity to speak to the children of two of our early pastor's pearls, Eunice Neal, wife of Pastor George Neal, as well as the late Marie Tuggle, wife of Pastor Reggie Tuggle. First, we'll introduce you to Pearl Eunice Neal.
Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus wore.
Pearl Eunice Neal served alongside her husband, Reverend George Neal, from 1969 through 1972. I had the pleasure of interviewing Andrew Neal and Lisa Nelson Neal, her son and daughter-in-law, who still attends Memorial today. Her family migrated from Barbados to Montreal, Canada. She was born in Montreal, Quebec, Canada, and spoke French fluently. Her uncle was the minister of the largest West Indian church in Montreal, so she grew up in the church. She was very supportive of her husband, Reverend Neil. She was also a very humble person. Although she had no daughters, Pearl Eunice was very supportive of women and young girls. She was a Girl Scout leader and would take her sons on camping trips with the Girl Scouts. She was involved in multiple ministries of the church, Sunday school, youth ministries, and was very instrumental in organizing the family retreats. Family retreats were very popular at MPC in those days. This was a retreat that dedicated the weekend to the entire family unit. They would camp out, eat, have various fun activities for the different age groups in the family. No one was left out. As a boy, Andrew looked forward to those weekends with great anticipation. These family retreats helped to foster an incredible sense of unity, love, and support in the church. Pearl Eunice was very family and community oriented. She was very supportive of the arts and creativity and was on the board of a museum. Pearl Eunice Neal loved to cook, and she was an excellent cook.
Next, we present to you Pearl Marie Tuggle through a reflection shared by her daughter, Regine Tuggle Moore.
Our next Pearl is Marie Tuggle, the late wife of Reverend Reginald Tuggle and the mother of Carlina and Regine. Marie loved gospel music. Her favorite artist was Helen Baylor. Regine recalls that she played it all the time, in the car and at home. Her daughters knew the songs as well as she did. Marie didn't care much about the pomp and circumstance of being the wife of someone who was well known locally. Her heart and passion were her family, fostering good relationships, and utilizing her creative gifts. That was her ministry. She was not just creative, but she loved a challenge, thinking outside of the box. She not only challenged herself, but her children as well. To think beyond the obvious, never settle, never take the easy route. Marie's creativeness was showcased in the Mary Follies productions. She was the playwright, director, and costume designer. She also made tapestries that hung on the walls of the church, invoking the Trinity, as well as peace, love, and joy. She loved working with Gladys Gabot, who shared her creative vision. One of Marie's most memorable creative gem was an amazing robe she made for her husband, which Regine requested he wear when he officiated her wedding. Although gone too soon, her genuine character, her unparalleled God-given gifts that she lovingly shared will never be forgotten.
We also had the pleasure of speaking with our two most recent pastors' Pearls. We'll introduce you first to Pearl Yvette Beckett Tuggle, wife of Pastor Reggie Tuggle, being interviewed by our current pastors' Pearl, Donette Williams, Elaine Hines, Jolyn Kendrick, Malitha Pope, and myself, Donna Stewart.
Yeah.
Hi, Sister. How you doing?
Hey, sis. I'm good. How are you doing?
Well, we'd like you to tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay. Well, I am a native Long Islander. I was born actually in Glen Cove, grew up there in Locust Valley, went to school there, and then I actually grew up in the Baptist Church. When I was 7 years old, I distinctly remember the day when I asked my mother, I said, I want to be saved. I was seven. And she looked at me and said, do you even know what that means?
Wow.
And, you know, we had this conversation, and lo and behold, later on that year, I was the youngest person among those that were baptized. I think it was at the Union Baptist Church. We didn't have a baptismal pool at the First Baptist Church. Mm-hmm. And I remember that distinctly. And so I grew up in the church. And, you know, later on, I went to college up in Massachusetts and London. Then I came back and went to graduate school in New York. It started my career in marketing. I was a marketing executive. Mm-hmm. And years later, I joined Memorial Presbyterian Church. It was in 1991, and I will tell you that one of the things that really, you know, drew me to the church was the feeling of the Holy Spirit. I distinctly remember feeling that way, and the warmth of the people, and of course, the wonderful message that I heard. And so I joined that church and got involved with a number of the ministries there.
Okay, my question is, how comfortable did you feel about being a pastor's wife?
Well, I have been asked that question before, and honestly, I will tell you that it really wasn't as difficult a transition as one might think. And I think part of that is because I was a member and I knew of the church and I knew the people, and I had gotten involved in, you know, a number of ministries already, so that it wasn't really a difficult transition. And also having grown up in the church and with parents who were very involved in the church and who were always very close to the pastors. I remember as a child, always, you know, the pastors and their families would come to our house, and we always had a, you know, close relationship. And so for me, it just, I don't know, I guess it just felt like an extension of what I've always known. No. I never thought of myself that I was going to marry a minister, but it really wasn't a difficult transition at all. I would tell you that, I do remember asking Reverend Tuggle, you know, when we got engaged, so what are your expectations? Because I'm really very big on managing expectations. And I think it's really important in any relationship, even in a business relationship. Like I would always say to my boss, if I had a new boss, so like, what are your expectations of me? And here are my expectations of you. So the same kind of thing. And in that conversation, I remember him saying, you know, just be yourself. You know, like, you know, I said, are you expecting to do certain things? He says, no, just do what you know, you want to do to serve God. And, you know, so that's kind of, I really appreciated that, you know, it really meant a lot to me that he, you know, trusted me as a person to do what I felt I should do. But, you know, we also had this thing where, you know, I didn't want to do anything that's going to embarrass you, right? So if I do something, or if I wear something, you know, I remember having that kind of conversation with him. And, you know, again, it was just very frank and honest. And, you know, that conversation, that experience, I think, again, I really just helped to make you feel very comfortable with you know, that whole new status.
Absolutely. What ministries, Yvette, at Memorial, would you say were that you enjoyed the most, or that you felt the most creative in? I can think of one thing in particular, but I'll let you articulate that.
Well, I was a Sunday school teacher for about 13 years when I was at the church. And I taught first the young, I think it was like the primary, but then I spent most of that time with the junior high class, challenging, but that's where I spent most of my time. I was at one point the treasurer of the Sunday school. I was involved, and some of you may remember, we had a mentorship program with young girls called Charms, Christian Charms, Christian Charmettes. I was a leader in that. And then I was a lay leader for a time. And then after I married Reverend Tuggle, I think it was the year after, I was elected president of the Women's League. And I did that for about 4 years and really enjoyed that. But I have to say, the one ministry that, and I say this because, I mean, they're all great, but this was life-changing for me, okay? And that was Charisus. And I always get choked up because, you know, when I speak the truth, I really start to cry. But anyway, I really enjoyed it because it was beyond performance. It wasn't about performance. It was about worship. And it was another form, it is another form of worship.
Right.
That I just totally embraced. And I loved the fact that we spent time in the Word, which was really very important. And then it was like interpreting that and ministering right. to people. So for me, that was an awesome experience. And I would say, though, as the First Lady of the Church, I remember when I first said I was going to do this, I got a few raised eyebrows because of the First Lady and dance and barefoot. What? And I thought, well, yes, I am. That's exactly what I'm going to do. Why not? I just love that form of worship. And it's, as I said, it was very life-changing for me.
As we enter hashtag 101, what words of encouragement do you have for Memorial?
I would just say to just serve one another with love. I mean, Paul's work, Galatians and Ephesians, you know, and use your God-given gifts to do that. Use your gifts. My mother used to say, use your gifts lest you lose your gifts. Mm-hmm. And we all have gifts that God has given us. We use those for the glory of God and do it with joy. You know, be joyful about it because time just moves by so quickly.
Oh, yes, it does.
And when you do it with joy, you look back and you think about, like I am right now, all the great times that I had at Memorial and, you know, all the great treasures and memories that we made together. So those would be my words of encouragement, is to serve one another with love.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you. Wonderful.
In the following interview, you will be introduced to Pearl Antonia Damond, wife of Pastor Patrick Damond.
Yes, oh yes, oh yes, falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus, was the best thing I've ever done.
Hi, my name is Antonia Damond. I am a native of Jacksonville, Florida, and I currently reside in Chicago, Illinois. I am the very proud mom of Bryson Benjamin. I am married to Patrick. I love jazz and the New York Yankees. I am also a lifelong student of the church, where my call is constantly grounded in faith that seeks understanding, also known as theology. And at times, you may find me teaching graduate students who are interested in religion and theology or seeking to go into ministry. How did I meet my husband? Well, I met my husband, Patrick, my first year of seminary, Princeton Seminary. We met the first or second day of orientation. We became friends quickly. We began dating. And now we have been married for 16 years. How do you balance life, ministry, husband's ministry? Well, when Patrick and I met, each of us had already answered a call to ministry. And since then, we have been on a journey together to fulfill God's call on our lives. Whatever Patrick has needed me to do, I'm in there to support. And likewise, he has done the same for me. And together, we have pursued God's call. God has brought into balance every aspect of our lives. We have seen the fulfillment of Matthew 6:33, that when you seek first the kingdom of God and all of God's righteousness, then everything else will be added unto you. And so I'm incredibly grateful for that. Oh, my fondest memory at Memorial. I have many fond memories during our time at Memorial. But some of my fondest memories are really, really practical, practical memories. During our tenure at Memorial, I was a new mom. When we arrived at Memorial, The boys were a little over one, and then they progressed to toddler years, and so on. And I would get them ready on Sunday mornings, and on occasion, I would be late. And sometimes, by the time I arrived at church, I would be tired because somebody had an accident or someone had a tantrum. Anything could happen. But what I remember is when we finally arrived, because again, sometimes I'm ashamed, I would be late. There would be someone waiting either to take them to the nursery, especially when they were younger. And as they got older, there would be breakfast waiting for them. And they were treated like royalty. I recall Mr. Kimball, Mr. Reddick, Mr. Bernard, and a few others would have their breakfast ready, and they would pull out their chairs and get them all situated. And I was greeted with such warmth and care and non-judgment, and I really was able to be free in those Sunday morning moments and sit and worship in peace and gather myself, if you will. At times, I would even just sit in the fellowship hall in the overflow and just be. Those moments are such fond memories for me because it's really a demonstration of Christian love and hospitality. And as Memorial enters into its 101st year, I would encourage Memorial to uphold that same sweet, sweet spirit of Christian love and hospitality, because that is what the heart of the ministry of Jesus Christ is all about. So as the people come, because they will come, that Christian love, that beautiful love, that hospitality that you extended to my family is what I encourage you to continue to extend to them.
And in our final interview, we will introduce you to our current pearl, Donette Williams, wife of Pastor Scott Williams, being interviewed by Elaine Hines, Jolene Kendrick, Malitha Pope, and myself, Donna Stewart.
Come on, let's go. We are a chosen generation. We've been called for to show His excellence. Hey, all I require for life, God has given me, and I know who I am. We are a chosen generation. We've been called for to show His excellence. All I require for life, God has given me, for I know who I am. I know who God says I am, what He says I am, where He says I'm at. I know who I am.
Well, good evening, First Lady Donette. How are you today?
I'm doing well, thank you. I'm doing well, thank God.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Let's see. I was raised in the church. The church is all that I know, basically. My parents migrated from Jamaica here when I was very young. So I was two when I came to the States. And so I feel even though I was born in Jamaica, I feel like I was also born in the church. Because my mother told us that she went looking for a church, just walking up and down the streets in Brooklyn, finding a church. So both my parents loved the Lord and served the Lord. And they told us to serve the house of the Lord, that was our primary thing to do. So I love the Lord. I'm one of seven. I'm the second oldest. And I came with a lot of responsibilities. I love to cook. And so being the second oldest, you either love to cook or you love to clean. So I love to cook. And both my parents were wonderful cooks. And so they really taught me, and I just took a knack to it. I found such peace in cooking. So I do enjoy cooking and I love to be creative. Just having sisters, I have four sisters and two brothers. You know, my mom also was a seamstress in addition to working and raising. So she taught us like how to sew. I don't know how to sew now, but she taught us how to sew and how to mend and how to create, crochet and all those things. So I do enjoy doing that. That also gives me a lot of peace. It helps me to relax and center myself. I am a social worker, a licensed social worker. I work in the school and I absolutely love it. And this is my second career. Prior to that, I worked for an investment banking firm for 18 years. As you know, we have two beautiful children, Samuel and Jessica. They are the apple of my eye. I love them and I love family. I love family. I love working with women and children and families and supporting them in whatever way, because I really do feel that they are the foundation of our society. And I feel that we all have a role to play in supporting family, because it really does take a village.
And could you just tell us, how did you meet your husband?
Oh, well, that's a funny story. I met him at church. So I was attending a church years before we were formally introduced. My old church had a choir. I sat in the choir just about all my life. And we had a concert. And so we invited different groups to come. So pastor's group was part of a group and they would minister out. And so they came to our concert to sing. And I remember Clara's day, I was sitting in the back of the church and I said to one of my girlfriends, like, who is that light-skinned brother singing? And she said, oh, I know him. I know him. He goes to whatever church in Brooklyn. So after he sang, he went to sit down and he sat down next to this lady. And they were like whispering to each other and talking. So I said, oh, that must be his friend or whatever. Never saw him again. Never saw him again. Fast forward, maybe about 4 years later or so, my pastor at that time left and went to Virginia. And so I was looking for another church. And so I spoke to my girlfriend and she said, remember that group that came to sing a couple of years ago? And I was barely remembered. And she said, they're in Brooklyn. And she said, I think you will like that church. So I went to the church. I remember calling up the operator, because that was back in the day when there was an operator. And I gave her the name of the church. She told me how to get to the church. And I went to the church. When I walked in, I saw him up there. I think he was leading the choir. And I looked at him like, he looks so familiar. So come to find out that it was, in fact, him that I saw about four whatever years ago. He was a youth pastor. He invited me to their youth service. Again, I didn't know anybody at that church. He invited me and he said, and I went and I would just leave because I had a curfew. Even though I was like 20, I still had a curfew. And I would leave to take the train to go home. And one day he ran after me. He goes, where are you going? And I said, I got to get home. I got to take the train. He said, where do you live? And I told him, he goes, oh, I don't live that far from there. Please don't take the train. I'll drop you home. And the rest of it. I mean, it was just really, it was the Lord. It really was.
So divine intervention.
Yes, it was.
So, Sister Nanette, I have the next question.
Yes.
How comfortable did you feel about being a pastor's wife?
That's a great question. You know why? Because one of my prayers to the Lord from a very young age was that I did not want to be married to a pastor.
Really?
Yes. I told you, I grew up in the church. And so my former pastor who migrated to Virginia, we were very close with. Matter of fact, my dad was like a founding member of that church. And so we would go to their house. And they were a beautiful couple. They were beautiful. But I saw the stress and I saw how involved they were in the ministry. You know, and we loved, and to this day, they're, you know, I'm still connected to them and I love them. And, but I just always said, and not want to be married to a pastor. There's so much responsibility and, you know, they have meetings and they have this and that. So I was like, Lord, I just, you know, Please, not only that, but then you couldn't sit next to them. So a lot of the pastors that I knew that were married, you know, you go to church together and then you separate. So the pastors are on the pulpit and the wives sit down in their seat and their bottoms, and then you look around. Yeah, and you look around and you see couples, their hands are around each other, and you're like, oh, they can't do that. So I always say, Lord, I don't want it, but I have learned my lesson not to tell the Lord what I don't want. I've learned my lesson.
Yes. My question is, how do you balance your professional life, your family, and supporting your husband in ministry?
You know, I think as women, we're constantly figuring out how to balance our lives, right? And I don't think it's unique to a pastor's wife. I think it's just, it may be an added thing that we have to balance. And I would say, first and foremost, it's really developing and feeding your spiritual relationship with the Lord, right? Having that personal relationship with the Lord. That's number one, because, you know, days when I feel like I can't do it, days when I feel I'm exhausted, or, you know, I just want to come home and kick up my feet and whatever, you know, it is that inner strength that comes from the Lord that lets you know that you can do all things through Christ, which strengthens you. That's number one. I think having that relationship with the Lord and knowing his voice and knowing when to say no, which is also a major thing. I learned over the years how to say no. Right. I've learned over the years how to say not now. I've learned over the years to say, let me think about it and pray about it.
About it, right.
Right? So I think if, you know, in doing that, and again, as women, that is so hard for us to do because we want to please, right? We want to serve, we want to give, we want to be that nurturer. And a lot of times we forget to take care of ourselves. And so I have learned in balancing that I've learned how that I have to say no sometimes, and I have to say, you know, let me think and pray about it and really do that. Because sometimes we think and we pray about it and then we just do whatever it is that we, because we don't want to hurt people's feelings and we don't want to think that, you know, we're not being there. So right. I've learned that it's okay to say no, and it's okay to give yourself a pause. That's what balancing. Also, making sure that I think self-care has to be intentional. And I've learned that over the years. It cannot just be something that we say, you know, that it's important. It's something that we must do. Whether you decide to do that, and Pastor and I have been married a very long time. This year will be 32 years. And so we have grown together. And so I had to grow into learning some of these things and balancing. Right. I didn't know how to do it at first. So it was the grace of God and surrounding myself with women who paved the path for me. You know, women who I look up to and who was able to show me, you know, that I have to take care of myself, that it's okay to go out and do things for myself. I had to learn how to go out and have a meal by myself, that it's okay to, you know, go to a restaurant and sit down and have a nice dinner. It's okay to go somewhere and just read a book or just go somewhere. I had to learn how to be by myself. Again, I came from one of seven. There was always people around. So right. It was very difficult, but once I did it, then it was so much easier for me to balance my life, because I knew the triggers and I knew when it was time for me to do a reset.
Right. Perfect.
So I have the next question for you. Since becoming First Lady only in October, not that long ago, and during a worldwide pandemic, you have hit the ground running at Memorial Presbyterian Church. And we just wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit about some of the ministries and activities that you've worked on or been participating in since you've been at Memorial.
But 2020 has been like no other year. That's number one. It really hasn't. And if nothing else, it has taught us that time waits for no one. Mm. It has taught us how precious time is and people. And so it would've been wonderful to be able to sit back and to say, oh, I'm gonna give myself a year or two, get to know. But you know, the lesson that I learned is that why put off for tomorrow? Because it really is not promised. So I have been attending and been enjoying and involved with the anniversary committee, and it's been such a blessing, because it's interesting that because I have not been able to meet the entire congregation all together in one place without a mask, attending the meetings for the anniversary, it is almost like I'm getting the background information of who the people are. And I don't know if church, if everything was the way it was prior to the pandemic, if I would have had that or received that. So I see it as such a blessing to know the rich history of this church and to get to know the pioneers and the people who really invested their time and talent and sweat. It's a lot of sweat equity that went into the church. So being involved with the anniversary, it really has been an such great lessons, I want to say. So I look forward to going and hearing what people are doing, and just hearing about the watching the documentaries, and just kind of like having firsthand knowledge of Memorial and of the amazing work that Memorial has done. And it makes me excited, because I keep saying, like, a, you know, almost like a child, Lord, where are you taking us now? Like, such a great and rich history. Like, what do you have for us now to do? Right. Because I know that there is more for us to do. So that's number one. Also, getting involved with the women's ministry as well, attending and being able to sit back and to be part of the discussions. I love the Sister Circle. I always loved the name Sister Circle to begin with. But the topics have been wonderful. The discussions have been wonderful. You know, getting to know the women on a different level as well, that has been great. So the women's ministry has been great as well. I am hearing about our children's ministry. I attended Sunday school once and it was wonderful. And, you know, I've been a Sunday school teacher for many, many, many years. And, you know, I love working with children. So I am excited again and meeting the Sunday school teachers and hearing such joy that they have. And I would say also the music ministry, again, as music is also something I'm very passionate about, and it has been such a tremendous joy and has ministered to me.
All right. Well, that's great. Well, we appreciate your getting involved as quickly as you have and in all the different ways that you have.
Absolutely. And your excitement. I just love your energy and your ease in which you do things. It's awesome.
Thank you.
As we come to the close of this presentation, our Pastor's Pearls, we hope you were blessed to be able to get a glimpse into the lives of the women who stood and are standing beside the men who were called to be servant leaders of this great church. Please continue to pray for these vessels of value, that they will continue to walk into their God-given talent. God bless you. Thank you for watching, and may God bless you always and in all. Thank you.